We have with us Mr. S.K. Bhattacharya, one of the leading educationists in Delhi, who has over 5 decades of experience in the top level working in various schools. And he is presently the secretary manager of Bal Bharati Public School. Besides, he is the president of Action Committee of Private Unaided Recognized Schools, which is an apex body of the topmost private unaided schools all over India. Welcome, Mr. Bhattacharya. What exactly is the role of this organization? Brief us a little bit about it and what you are doing from this.
Delhi has almost about 2,000 private unaided recognized schools. That includes the schools which are up to the middle standard, and we also have about 600 plus number of schools which are full-fledged senior secondary schools. And the private schools in the last 50 years, they're now growing not only in the numbers, there's a huge demand also for the private schools. You will agree with me that almost about 50% of the children in Delhi are going to the private schools. We are very comfortable. There were no problem, there were no pressure, and the private schools were enjoying huge amount of autonomy. Autonomy in the sense that they were enjoying autonomy in regard to the management, in regard to the admission matter, in regard to the various other things, like, for example, fixation of fees and so on and so forth. First time we had a problem when the fifth way commission was implemented by the government, and there was a huge impact on the salary, and there was a demand, or there was a need for a hike in the fees also, otherwise it was not possible for the private schools to give the benefit of the fifth way commission salary and allowances in those days. The government for the first time interfered, and government said you cannot raise the fees. And ultimately we decided to form an association which can come together and fight. And in the year 1997, for the first time, all the various private schools associations, they gathered and then decided to set up this association called Action Committee of Private Unaided Schools, which is actually apex body or the umbrella organization of all the private schools associations. The most important objective of this particular organization was the safeguard of the interest and autonomy of the private schools. And the first victory of the private schools was, then when we approached the Supreme Court for the hike in fees, we were allowed to raise the fees by substantial amount. And the schools not only got the benefit of hiking the fees, they were also in a position to give the benefit of the fifth pay commission pay scales allowances. And that is the beginning of the Action Committee. And thereafter, 1973, you know, the Delhi Education Act and rules, no many rules and regulations were framed to regulate and control the private schools. And therefore, there was a need for some kind of unity, some kind of organization which can fight for any kind of wrong things imposed on the private schools.
So the general impression which the education department tries to give is that the schools, all these schools need to be reined in. They need to be checked on fees, they work arbitrarily, they do not listen, and as if the government is controlling them. What do you have to say on this?
First of all, I'd like to say this kind of allegation is absolutely wrong. There is no relevance in the allegations. I'll give you one or two examples to prove my point. First of all, let us find out what is the cost of education in a government school. As per their own statement for the year 2018 and 2019, the cost of education in a government school was 6,200 rupees per child per annum, per month, I'm sorry. 6,200 rupees per child per month, which comes to about 72,000 to about 75,000 per annum. If this is the cost of education in a government school, which are only considering the establishment part, not the other expenses, if you also include the other expenses, for example, building, construction, property, maintenance and all, the cost of education would be almost about 80 to 90,000 rupees per annum. Mm. Against that, if the private schools are charging fees between 4,000, 5,000, a maximum 6,000 rupees per month, what is wrong? We need the money because we are the schools not getting any kind of a grant or aid from the government. Our only source of income is the income from the fees. The schools are charging fees reasonably so that they can meet all their expenses. A government has got all the power to check if any particular school is doing anything wrong. The government has every power to check and regulate. But why this kind of a regulation for on all the schools? And you have created all kind of fear, psychosis in the minds of the people, in the minds of the private school organizations. But you have not even considered the genuine demand of a private school. Why have you not done it? Number of schools are suffering because they don't have the money. They are facing lots of deficit in their accounts. Despite of that, the government has decided not to give any benefit to the school. Why so? Why so? I have the example where the school's income is about only 10 crore rupees, but their expenses come to more than 13 crore rupees per month, per annum. Why are you not allowing these schools to make up the deficiency, the deficit? They need 13 crore rupees and their income is only 10 crore rupees. How they are going to meet the deficit? So these are the basic questions that government has never addressed to. I am saying that if any private school indulging any kind of wrong practices, there should be all kind of a control on such. But do you think that all the 2,000 schools are doing wrong? My question is this. Out of the 2,000 schools in Delhi, there may be a handful of schools we are indulging in kinds of wrong practices. You have every right to control them. But what you are doing now, you are trying to control all the 2,000 schools. What is the result of that? Number one, not only the financial problem with the institution, it is also impacting on the quality education. Number two, suppose I want to employ the best of the teachers and the best of the teachers are only available, I am ready to pay higher kind of a salary to the teachers. Not necessary for the private school only to stick to the government pay scales. If I want to improve my quality education, I must have the right to employ the teachers with a higher salary. Are you giving that opportunity to me? And therefore, what is all happening? It is impacting on the quality education. Number three, what the people want? Why the people are sending their children to schools? They only want that the children should get good quality education so that at a later stage when they are going for higher education, they are fully equipped with that. Is it happening here in Delhi? I can give the example of the government schools. I don't want to undermine the importance of the government schools. I know the government schools are also required. Ultimately, all cannot pay the fees at that range of 5,000, 600 rupees. There should be some government school where education is given free of cost. I am 100% in favor of that. But along with that, there should also be some provision for providing quality education. Private schools are mainly meant to provide the quality education where not only they are confined to the classroom teaching, they are also providing holistic education where there is an element of personality development, communication skill, games and sports, and all the other aspects which are important for the development of the holistic education for the children. And you would believe that that is the duty that the private schools are discharging very honestly with a lot of credit. That's the reason that there's a demand for a private school. And I believe that what we are doing in a private school is the role of the government. Constitution says that education is the subject of the government. Right. It is a state subject. It is the responsibility of the state to provide free and compulsory education. If they have failed to provide the free and compulsory education, whose fault is that?
You mean to say that instead of doing their own duty,
they are not discharging their own duties.
And they are trying
suppose
to put
they can
on.
Create so many number thousands of schools in the country, and they are providing quality education. Who is joining the private schools? It is because of the failure of the state government, state education system, that the people are interested to send their children to private schools. Because they hope that in the private schools, not only our children will get care, they will also get it, they'll all be getting good quality education comparable with the, say, international standard.
So is the machinery listening to your demands?
See, when the machinery is not listening to a demand, and there are obvious reasons, I don't want to explain that. There can be some political agenda also of the government. I don't want to go into all the details. But unfortunately, they are not listening to the reasoning, the logic. If they listen to our logic, if they listen to our exactly our rationality of deciding fee structure, all the problems can be sorted out without any problem. I say that you please check the cost of education in private schools. The cost of education is why that they should at least allow the schools to charge that money which will meet the cost of education. What are the components of the cost of education? First of the establishment cost, salary part. 70% of the expenses are only on establishment, and 30% expenses on building, construction, maintenance, property tax, electricity, water, so on and so forth. Apart from that, allow at least 10 to 15% of the saving which can be utilized for future development, which is also the judgment of the Supreme Court. Supreme Court has very clearly mentioned that every school must have certain amount of saving. Otherwise, where is the possibility of provision for growth or for sustenance? For growth and sustenance, there has to be some kind of a provision for saving. Otherwise, tomorrow, if there is any crisis, I will have no other provision. I will die automatically because I don't have any provision for that. So these are some of the very elementary things that the government has not considered. Government thinks, no, the schools are making profit. Where is the profit? If not a single High Court judgment has said that schools are indulging any kind of a commercial activity. I want to see any judgment of any court.
But there is no doubt that there are certain schools which there are certain schools which are found to be erring at one point or other. I mean to say, you are right that you are saying I that the government has to check it, yes sir,
I said
wherever
right
there is
the
an big, error. But sir, can there be a self-regulatory mechanism?
Absolutely
somewhere?
Right. Absolutely. I fully 100% agree with you. Number one, instead of control, there should be regulation. Control means you are strangulating. That strangulation, you are curbing that authority, you are curbing the autonomy, is not a solution. But regulation is absolutely necessary. But the regulation, there should be certain guidelines. So far, Delhi does not have any fee regulatory committee. For example, Maharashtra had a fee regulation act, Punjab has a fee regulation act, Uttar Pradesh has recently created a wonderful, you know, provision of fee regulation act, where there is a balance. Number one, they have considered the requirement of the private institution. On the other hand, they have also taken into consideration there should not be any exploitation of parents. So there is a proper balance. I say, why don't you create some kind of fee regulation act where they can decide the formula for deciding a fee structure, number one. Number two, if any school is indulging any kind of commercial activity or any activity which is unwarranted, the government has got every power to go and curb them and control them.
The draft national education policy means that has been put for the individuals to respond upon on them or for the general citizens to respond. What exactly do you feel are the salient features and where are the lackings in that?
See, the NEP 2019 is a very good document. And for the first time, NEP 2019, talking about education, right from preschool education up to the higher education. This is the first document so far, which has also taken into consideration the pre-primary education, which was not the part of education policy so far. Very important, I think, the thing which have been included now in the education policy. You see, a huge number of children are going to the preschools and pre-primary schools, which have remained under the unrecognized, unorganized sector. With the inclusion of the preschool and pre-primary education, the quality of education for the preschool and pre-primary shall further improve. Because they will also come under some kind of rules and regulations regarding the fee structure, regarding the infrastructure, regarding the curriculum, and so on and so forth. So I believe this is a wonderful thing in the NAP 2019. They have also mentioned about various programs for improving our standard of education. They have also talking about the teacher development program. They have also spoken about the BA training program, which is important to become a teacher. They want to improve the quality of a training program for the teachers. Again, a very good thing. They have also discussed about the introduction of technology. They have also talked about the skill-based education. I believe these are the wonderful suggestions, a wonderful recommendation. But the problem here that I am not very much comfortable with, see, even earlier policies, they were also good. We're talking about the Kodaliya Commission report of 1952, or talking about 1964 Kothari Commission report, or talking about 2005 in any new education policy. In all of the recommendations, there were good points. The question is, was there any political will? I think that was the only lacking, that is lacking the political will. India requires investment of almost 8 to 11% on education from the GDP. What is our investment on education today? Only 3.5% to 3.7%. Against the requirement of 11%. If you want to take country at par with the advanced countries in terms of good and quality education, you have to bring a lot more investment on education, which is not happening. On the other hand, you are also not encouraging the private sector to make investment, because if you want the private sector to enter into the education and make investment, you have to give them some kind of autonomy and some kind of encouragement also. Unless and until you are not giving those kind of facilities and all, why the private sector come and enter and start giving, making all investment in the education sector? So there's a need to also rethink over these issues so that we are inviting more investment on education, and investment in education will certainly be in the greater benefit of the children, because with that investment you can improve the quality of education, infrastructure and everything and all.
In the near future, do you see that the private sector or the corporate world will come into the education field? They have already started coming this in a big way.
This is a big question, because you see, when in the private sector started taking interest in education in the beginning of say 50s or 60s, the participation was very minimum. But today, almost 50% of the children are in the private schools. That means there is no alternative. Government has to make provisions so that there is more investment, and private sector is also taking part in education in a big way. So there is a possibility of lots of money changes, and even the corporate sector may be allowed to enter into education. Why not? Even suppose the people are making profit, okay, you have every provision of putting all kinds of taxes and everything under the Companies Act. Do whatever is required to be done. So therefore, when you are talking, talk about the other possibilities. You have to open your mind, understand what is the need of the country, what is the realistic kind of policy to be adopted. Because our interest is how best we can enhance the quality of education and can eradicate illiteracy, which is a blot on our democracy. That even today, after 73 years, only 87 or 88% children are educated. And when talking about educated, they are really not educated. It is only a question of 3 hours. And a survey was conducted very recently. A child in the fifth standard does not know how to solve a very basic problem of math, addition and subtraction. Is it the kind of quality education that we are providing, and that is the policy of the government? Must think over the matter. Must have another thought whether we should change our policy.
Do you think with all the publicity that the government schools are changing, are they really changing on the ground level?
I don't want to say anything because this is the policy of the government. Government every day is bringing out some advertisement, something, and they want to change the mindset of the people with advertisement and all. But what is the ground reality? There's a big question mark.